Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 6th NUS Cities Public Lecture Series. Before we start the event, a kind request, kindly either switch off your phones or put them on silent. Thank you. For those of you who don't know about NUS Cities, we are a university-wide, multidisciplinary, open and inclusive collaborative platform hosted within the College of Design and Engineering, otherwise known as CDE. Through our collaborations with our local and international institutions, we hope to create synergies that extend within as well as outside NUS. The NUS Cities Public Lecture Series will investigate policies, ideas, and projects developed by urban experts which aspire to create sustainable, resilient, and livable cities. Through the lecture series, we hope to create a platform for discussion, retrospection, and conversation to give momentum to the ongoing research and exploration regarding issues concerning cities. I would now like to introduce our speaker of the evening. Herbert Dreiseitl is an urban designer, landscape architect, water artist, interdisciplinary planner, and professor in praxis. His focus is on creating livable cities and urban landscapes around the world with a special hallmark on the inspiring and innovative use of water. He's an international renowned expert and has realized groundbreaking contemporary projects in the field of climate resiliency, stormwater management, urban planning, and landscape architecture, like Tanner Springs Park in Portland or Bishan Ang-Mo Kio Park in Singapore. He had founded Atelier Dreiseitl in 1980, now known as RSD or Ramboll Studio Dreiseitl, and developed the Livable Cities Lab. Today, Herbert is an independent consultant for many cities and initiatives around the globe. His work integrates regenerative processes, demonstrating a portfolio of site-responsive interventions of community-based urban planning and environmental-sensitive engineering. Through a collaborative network as Harvard GSE Loeb Fellow and regular visiting professor at the National University of Singapore, Herbert and his wife, Bettina, created Dreiseitl Consulting and are currently giving workshops and advice to many initiatives in cities to improve their projects with resiliency and regenerative frame conditions. Please join me in welcoming him on stage.
So we have to start it.
Yes.
Okay. Can you hear me? Clear enough? Thank you. And I just need this one. Well, it's a great honor for me to be here, to be invited, to see so many friends and people I know from many, many meetings. And I'm really happy to be here, invited to this program, which is for me very, very interesting, the NUS Cities, a new program here, which I really enjoy very much the time I'm here, because it's very connecting, combining very different disciplines. In a very interesting way, including the questions how to do projects, how to do policy making, how to integrate different disciplines in a very smart and intelligent way, which I think is extremely important if we want to do things more sustainable, but also to include include people into the whole thing. So without some delay, I would just like to today to make a bit of a journey with you. What it is about talking about water and working with water, and also on different continents, how do actually people work in different climate zones? And I'm just trying to, now I have to see if it works or not. It doesn't work at the moment. Okay, now it should work. Okay, so I had always a very, very nice colleagues, and I was very, very lucky to have a lot of young people who joined my teams. And just to make it very clear, I'm here just as a person, not as a company or so, because I wanted to say, when I'm getting 70, I want to get rid of all these things about managing big teams, because it's so tiring and it's so demanding. So I said, I want to be really more coming back to my roots, to work more on questions on philosophy, to work on really important questions with some pilot projects, and to help also young people to go forward. And I also know that I have lots of my colleagues who actually were working with me together, which have new companies coming up, new enterprises, and they bring the the movement out. And I'm so, so proud about this because I often see them and I'm really very happy. So we have done together many, many projects around the world which are all connected to water. They are connected to questions on climate, questions on resiliency, but they are also connected to people. How can you include humans, the human question, really to work on, oh, wonderful, my wife is just coming from Germany, she just landed, and that is wonderful, that Bettina, welcome. So it's really a kind of question, how can you include a lot of things, because water is actually teaching that. I'm also, I started my work 1980 as an artist. So I had my art studio, and I still go back to artwork, and that's why I will at the end show you one project we are just doing, which is really back to the roots, and I'm working on art projects, because I think design really matters. You know, we are so often just focusing on engineering and technical solutions, which are important. That's no matter, there's no doubt. I'm very, very sort of precise on questions on when it comes to details, when it comes to the question how to work on engineering topics. But we are here also at the School of Environment and Design. So how do we bring good design and good technical solutions together? That is a very, very important question. And actually, it's interesting that when you look at water, water is actually showing this, because when we start, and when you, that's why I put this question up, why do we start with art and not with science or engineering or water and architecture? It really comes to the point when we look at water, when we look at water structures, here in Singapore, on the coastline, on history, it is all about an enormous way of form, of creativity, of transformation, of change process. There is never something where we can say, this is it. There is always, water shows us that we have to be resilient, that we have to be flexible, that we have to be, that we have to adapt to new situations, which is, by the way, something we also need in our life. You know, as humans, we always have to, we can never say something for granted. We always have to actually rediscover new relationships with even people we know very well, because they also change and we change. So it's a permanent process of development, which actually water is showing us in many, many ways. So we can learn a lot of that. And of course, that is very important that we see this. So art is much more than just, you know, making something nice or having decoration. I think it's very important. I often do little experiments, and I just have that one. We just did it, actually, but this is an old film where actually Bernd Chernow, who was also a student of mine, made this film to see the inner movements of water structures, where you can see even a water which is going downhill on a plexiglass plate is starting to make curves, left and right shaped curves. It's all kinds of rhythm phenomena you can see in this structure. And we find them again in nature. We find these structures of oxbows, of curves in many, many landscapes on all planets. Yeah, if we are looking down from the airplane and we see the desert of the Sahara, or if we see the desert in Australia, we find all water forms. Very, very interesting, because when it comes to water, then it is enormous, rich of creativity. Of course, we have a lot of problems also with water. It is a challenging element where we have to deal with, and it's really the question how to balance things. Water can also show this very well, because it balances extremes, like temperatures. When we have no water, we have extreme hot and extreme cold day and night times, right? You probably know this when you go to a desert, a place where there's no water, there is actually no resiliency, there is no balance. So water is actually showing this, and it shows this always in very beautiful ways and very artful. So I often do also clay modeling. This is actually all done here at NUS. You know, this is actually where we still had the Van Cleef building. So we did several times, we made this kind of modeling, and it was only maybe 3 hours. But students learned so much. It was absolutely surprising. And if you look at the eyes of these guys, I mean, they're still telling me now. They said, you know, Professor, this was for us an eye opener and a mind opener. And so I think it's very important to see that, you know, what kind of inner structures, inner forms are there? Because then we can understand how actually nature works. We can see how structures come up. We can see even that little experiments, if you make a little, just take a stick and you pull it through a kind of a water bassin, and you just see what happens behind. Very, very interesting, very rich, different scales. By the way, this one is small scale. This is large scale. This is about 400 kilometers. This is a volcano stacking out of this cloud field, because water and air is very, very similar in the way how it fluidly sort of make movements. So the world is rich of this kind of very, very interesting structures. And that's why we have actually to learn from it. There are lots of people who are actually scientists on the Max Planck Institute, for example, in Germany, but also Leonardo da Vinci. We were always saying, well, we have to look very carefully to understand nature from a different point, not just from our head, but also with our emotions, with our, we have to go into this. We have really to see what are the sort of inner qualities of movements, of forces we have in nature. And I think that's very important then when we come to cities. When we see what we did on this planet, and with lots of reasons, of course, of being more more efficient, more focused, how to handle nature, how to handle risks, and all these questions, we create a kind of transformation of landscape. And we can see this in some countries very clear, for example, in the US with the Jefferson grid, which is slowly moving over. It was actually taking over an ownership in design of fragile landscape forms, and they were more and more structured to give fair plots to everyone, where everyone can have the same size for agriculture, for example. When we look at cities, and this is just in Germany a typical example, we made everything very straight, quick from A to B, our waterways, our streets, our train systems, our infrastructure, and we lost somehow the fragile flexibility what water actually can show us. Urbanization is even asking more for that. And when you look at pictures like this, what we have a lot in Asia, but we also have it in Europe, we have it in US, we have it in different parts of the world, in China, we have it in India, more and more coming up. Blue and green is more and more disappearing, because that's actually has no advocate. It has, somehow we think it has no value, right? Real estate development can be done with buildings, but not with the green space. It's maybe nice to have, but if we can afford it. If not, we take it away. So that's what we did for many, many generations. Now it comes back like a boomerang to us. And I think this is very important to see that every action has also a consequence. And the consequences we feel today is that we see that the change of our planet actually is coming in reverse, that we have suddenly different structures, for example, on how water reacts to this. We have suddenly particular very strong cloudbursts on one spot where very close by you have no rain coming down. We have, and I just don't want to show you too many slides on that, because you can find this all on TV. You have seen it just a couple of days now. We had this flood, terrible floodings in Ireland. And this is just my country in Germany. You know, Germany is supposed to be a very civilized, high engineering country. But this was actually not long ago. It was just actually 2 years ago. Is it right? 2 or 3 years ago. We had this Arntal situation. Beautiful, lovely valley. Here's the river. This was what happening after we had an extreme thunderstorm, which we never had in this intensity. Look at this, the bridge gone. Here, the whole thing flooded. People were dying. Houses were destroyed. And big questions came up. How to do it again? Can we learn to make it different? I have to say, we only learned a little bit, but we still were not consequent enough in Germany to make a real big change. That's my personal opinion. When you look at these pictures here, I mean, this is really shocking. I mean, this is actually that you can see here's the village, here's a farm. This is all gone. This is like a canyon, actually starting in the middle of Germany, where the land is just taken away, in actually one night, right? One night of a thunderstorm coming down. This is not too far away now. I really go very close to my heart. This is actually my city. I'm living in a small city, very, very cozy, kind of Swiss-style small city, old city, 1,200 years old. And this is our train station. One night, there was so much water from a little stream by a cloudburst that the whole train station was completely flooded, and for 1 week, no train could go in and out. It was completely, luckily, we had at that night no trains and no people there. So water can be really extremely dangerous in the way how actually the climate change affects the water. And I think another point, which we also can see, this other side of the coin, is that we have long periods where we have no water. So it's getting more and more dry, it's more and more hot. We have more and more, for example, you have seen that what we had on forest fires in Canada, in Europe, in Greece, fires that the whole island where I was actually with my wife in Rhodos, all these places where we have been last year, they're all gone. They're all burned down. So the change of the water system and of the water balance by that the climate is reacting to this is dramatic. We can feel it already now and we can see it. And I want just to talk a little bit about it, not too long. What are the effects? And I think what is somehow also the question, I mean, this is a big scale thing, but it also comes to the question, how can we actually make our cities more resilient and our lifestyle better so that we can adapt ourselves to these changing conditions? And I think it is just, for example, to see in Germany. In Germany, we had the forecast, an old one here, but not so long ago, actually maybe 15 years ago, we were thinking it's warming up, worst case scenario here. Now, the new forecast is showing it's much faster. So what we were thinking in the year 2000 is absolutely what we were thinking as worst case scenario are now even not the medium, the middle of what we have. So that is really a situation which is scary. And I think when we see where the heat is, the most of the hot zones are always there where the city is dense, where there's little green, where there's little evaporation, little green shelters like trees and so on. These are just some pictures we collected together to see the thermal environmental or the surface temperatures. And you can see immediately that the surface temperatures is where we have areas where we have forest, where we have green areas like here, the temperature is lower. And also at night, the temperature can drop down. In other places, not. But this is something you probably all know, so I don't have to go too deep into the details. Interesting is that global warming as a trend, this is actually in Germany from the research institute. I'm very always interested working with these guys together. And it's very interesting to see, you know, what is actually happening and what are our opportunities. With Globe 21, with a conference in Paris, where my wife and I were actually present and we were also giving presentations, we had still a hope to say, well, maybe if we act now quick enough, we can stabilize our temperature to just 1.5 to 2 degrees Celsius higher. And actually, to be honest, when I see how difficult politics are or is, because I'm also in one of the small parliaments in Germany, my city, as a political person, just simple decisions are so difficult already that I think we will more go to a tendency which is, if we don't do anything, actually will be even very, very bad. But actually we have somehow to find a way. Everyone has to contribute in a way that we at least make the planet so that our next generations can somehow live on this planet. And that has a lot to do with water. It's actually not new, because we know a long time already that water systems, environment, green, forests, CO2 emission, warming up, all these things are not new. They are known. Actually, I did a little bit research on before having this talk. And it's actually very interesting that even already in the 4th century before Christ, there were people saying, when we take marsh and forests away, the temperature will go up. And then later on, I mean, we have different interesting figures, and very interesting is, for example, this lady, Newton, she said, warming will be exposed because certain gases like CO2 will certainly warm up the temperature by that the sunlight is reacting to this. And we know then later, of course, of a lot of research, this was actually an interesting person who actually presented it also to the United States, to the government, and he got the gold medal from the president at that time. And he said, well, the CO2 is going up, the temperature is going up, and we can see that there is really a kind of absolutely scary situation where we have somehow to find better solutions. So I don't want to see too black, but because I think there's always hope, and that is very important. Where especially for you students, you know, I mean, I know a lot of students are listening here, and it's very important that we actually use any opportunity we have in our profession, in our influence we have to friends, to others, to actually make a change or to make things better. And working on architecture, working on engineering, working on policy making, working on finance questions, what to finance and what not, and where do we see value coming up? That is an extremely important part where you can make a change. So I think very important is to look a little bit on different continents, how water management was done as blue-green infrastructure in different areas. I just take first Europe, and I do it very much from a personal experience, because I started my work 1980 with these questions. We had a lot going on in Switzerland, where if you imagine in Switzerland and also many other countries, rainwater was seen as wastewater, and it was always combined with sewer and out of sight and out of mind. And we slowly started by some projects, and I will share one very soon, that we had to change actually the way how we see capturing rainwater. We were seeing, aha, wait a while, the only water we have, we get, is rain. Rain is creating actually drinking water. Everything we have in lakes and rivers, in the groundwater, is first rain. So it's not waste, it's not something we have actually to take care of it. Even in a city, we have to take care of that. So we have to change all our regulations. Germany started also very soon to come up with new regulations, and the European Water Framework Directive also followed and made very clear conditions. In Europe, we look very much on catchment areas. So we say, for example, the Danube has different structures than the River of Rhine. So each has a different type of hydraulic and also limnology. That's the microorganism in the water, sorry. I'm always mixing up German and English. And that has actually to be very much focused on every system. So every system needs, according to that, the right regulations. And that's a way how we actually work there. Very early things came out in Switzerland, 1980. I did write with Wolfgang Geiger already very early a book called New Ways of Rainwater, and it was very, very important. I just like to share you one small project, what I did try out, very naive. I tried to work on villages in Switzerland. This is in the French part of Switzerland, Echallon, Suisse Romande. And I started to say, let's not waste water in canals. Let's keep it on the surface as far as we can go. We keep it, we collect it, we make slopes. We have hundreds of such little open drain systems. And we reach this water, we bring it into kind of little green spots. We filter it through here. We hold it back when it rains. The water can go up and down. It was more like a bringing landscape architecture and water engineering and art somehow together. That was the point at this point. I was not doing actually any hydraulic complicated calculations. You know, I was not looking at certain KPI or guidelines or so. It was not known at that time. It's just common sense. And actually, I would like your students also to encourage you, when you start to work on things, use your common sense. What is a natural process? What is needed? What is the logic? Don't look only on books. What is it describing you? Or when you give a when someone brings an idea, start with your common sense. Does it make sense? Is it right? Is it in harmony with a natural process? And then you come up with good solutions. Well, out of that, of course, a lot of other things came up. How to use water in dry or wet seasons. We did it in Germany. Then later on, we did it also in Singapore on different areas. I started later to make very large projects for like an army base from the American Nelling Barracks to change them completely, make a new city with green roofs. Every drop of rainwater in this project is actually collected, is slowing down, is treated, is filtering, is even going into a little small river. And you know what? We had 2002, we had an extreme storm event. It was just finished in Stuttgart. In the city of Stuttgart, and a lot of floodings in the city. No flooding here, because we could keep it all back, we could hold it back. And when it is very dry, we still have water in our streams, because this is like a sponge. The city is like a sponge and it's reacting, keeping water, letting it out slowly. Also, when it's dry, still a little bit water. So all the little animals we have in our river systems can survive. Because if they fall dry, then this ecosystem actually collapses completely. And when there's a lot of water, it can suck in, it can hold back. So that's a very, very important principle. And of course, that can be done large scales. I was very lucky that I could work for the World Exhibition 2000 in Hannover. And I had to work, of course, with basic structures and principles and engineering details. Working out on large corridors to hold it back, sometimes even to protect the groundwater, because we had some places also with pollution, or there's no infiltration opportunities, so you have to do it different. There's a lot of kind of things you need to think about. It looks so easy, right? But there's a lot of thinking behind to make projects in this scale work. So again here, a whole city dealing with it. I go to a very last European example, modern city or an old city, which is in a transition at the moment. It is the city of Basel. This area was the big region for chemistry. So all these big companies at the time, Bayer, Sandoz, and so on, they were actually having there the headquarters. And a lot of pollution actually was going into here. Basel decided, we want to make this the most green possible city we can have there in this city. So we want to treat all the water on site. We want to keep it. We want to clean it. We want to recycle some of the buildings. We look for any opportunity on buildings to hold back even small swales. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is so important. Very often we think, also in Singapore, too much. We get the water together and then we make our drains better. No, we lost. You know, the thing where you have to start to think is the catchment area in the very first beginning, where the water, the rainwater is actually hitting or touching the surface. Rooftops, gardens, HDB buildings or areas, there is where action needs to be done. That's very, very important as a message. You have to look also for streets. So we were looking a lot in how can we actually make the streets more with swales and holding the water back. What can we do to actually have little pocket parks where we collect water, where we have maybe even a sponge in the underground, where in dry periods we still have humidity, so we have different trees we can hold back so that the trees can survive also in dry periods, so that we have actually a climate resilient park where neighbors can go out and can meet. And I think we know this in Singapore very, very well. You know, when it's so hot, when you have a shelter and you have some trees, it's still okay to walk outside. But if that is missing, no one wants to go out. Then we use our air cons, we use our cars, and then we, of course, create this kind of spiral that CO2 emission and all this is going higher and higher and higher. And then we come to all the problems we have seen before. So it's a very important part, and I just skipped that one, that is Berlin Potsdamer Platz, large scale, where I learned a lot on this project. And the last one, even industry, I mean, this is not a very environmental friendly thing, but I just wanted to share this quickly. This is because Singapore has these Formula One cars, and this is McLaren. So on this factory, actually, I was very interested, or I did work here for McLaren with Norman Foster and his team, and it was very interesting to collect here water from the entire factory, from this building, but also from all the car parking lots. And we filter the water, we bring it into a lake system, and we circulate this water actually through a kind of cascade where there is a temperature drop, and we use this temperature difference, the delta of the in and outgoing water, to have a cooling system for the entire plant. And it works pretty well. This is, of course, close to London, or is in the bigger part of London. It would not work in this way in Singapore. That's also very important to know, where can you use what? Yeah? But I just wanted to share this just from a point of that. It's also interesting, the design and the structure of this, and it's very, very interesting. I go to North America. North America did start very early also to think about better solutions, because they were aware about the water problems. They had made the Clean Water Act. They had low impact development, the LDP, the green infrastructure came up. Cities like Portland, Oregon, cities like New York, Philadelphia especially, started early on to think about ways, how can we work more smart, more resilient with water in our cities. So I was very happy to also be in America very early on, work on that. So the low impact development was actually starting with very good graphics. This is the old fashioned way. This is the new way how we could do it. This has so many added values and side effects, like filtration, like purification of water, where this is only a mechanical solution, right? And we could actually see that. So I was happy to work, especially in Portland, on one park with my team at that time, also with a local landscape architectural and engineering company called Greenworks. And we collected water from different sites. We created a kind of sponge. It was a wetland there in the past, and we recreated this wetland and collected it. And it's actually part of this Pearl District. Where we collect water, where we bring it in the park, where we actually let it filter through the landscape with a special layers. We collect it and recycle part of that, and clean water then finally goes out into the river. And of course, to do such things, and this is another important tool and point I would like to address to you students, this is not just an engineering solution or an architectural solution. This is something where you need to get the local people on board, because it's the public realm. It's their home. It's their place where they play. It's their living room. Yeah. How can you come as a designer and an engineer and say, I don't care about you and about your needs? You have to include them. Absolutely. So workshops, participation, involvement, very, very important, extremely important point. So my wife and I, we do this very, very often around the world. Whenever we can, we try to convince our client, you will be much better off if we invest in a workshop, because you will be much faster, much easier. That's actually also happened in this city, because the people were so much behind, and when we had a financial crisis, this project was not taken down. Others were. But we had so much support by the public that we were able to even hold on this project and do it, recycle material, work on it, work it out. And today it's a beautiful park. It's very much well kept, well cared. We have art things going on there. There are even friends of the park which do the maintenance. So the maintenance cost for the city is lower just by involving people. So that is a very, very important part, I think, which I think you can do in different cultures and different areas, and it's very much important. Let's make a step to Australia. Australia also has started early on. I remember I was on conferences like the Hydropolis in Perth. Mike Morris, we did discuss how could we call it. And actually, I think on a glass of beer, we said water-sensitive urban design. And actually with some other friends, this was getting a kind of term which was more and more actually established in Australia. And we had lots of friends actually who developed it or brought it up, very great colleagues who are working on this in Australia. And I think different guidelines also came out in Australia where you can actually see how that really works. And Tony Wong, for example, did really develop a lot with his wife on this point to come up with water-wise cities and to say it's more than just engineering. It needs to have a kind of wisdom what we have to bring in, which I think is very, very important. China, I don't want to go too deep into that because there are lots of interesting topics, but interesting was that this kind of tendency to come up with solutions which use water more sensitive, more smart, more clever, more intelligent was really going around the world. But I think the sponge city word was really established in China. They used this word then very strong. It was super easy, and then it was going back to Germany, to Europe, and we use it now also everywhere. So it's interesting how innovation, you know, goes from one continent to the other and then comes back. that's so important. I mean, I think on this planet, we have to exchange. We have to learn from each other, also learn from different cultures. Singapore now is also, for me, a very, very interesting country and city. And I think you are really, I have to say that, on many places on the forefront. But you also have to be careful that you don't rest and that you don't stop and that you don't really see that there is more to be done. So I think I would like just to mention that the ABC water guidelines, which really started in a very interesting way, that was actually how I was introduced. And Ku Teng Chai was PUB was CEO from PUB, was coming up with, we have to find better solutions, how to collect water, how to treat water, how to recycle it, and so on. So this word, active, beautiful, and clean, very smart, very clever. And I was happy at that time with my team to help several times to come up with the guidelines for that. Today, it's a whole process which is developed further. And I think it also has, not to forget, a whole development behind that. There was different panels already trying to find out. And I'm always impressed if I just think back about Lee Kuan Yew, how he actually had this vision of 1977 to say, the Singapore River once will be clean if we do it. We can do it. And it will be so that people can swim, we can see fish, all that we have. And when we look to other countries, you know, like the Ciliwung in Jakarta, no one can imagine. But we can also say that. Why not? I mean, that's really the way how I think pioneer thinking and innovation actually has come about. And that's what I would like to encourage you students also. Never give up. There's always something you can do. So, Singapore did, of course, a lot. And I think a very important part was density, how to deal with density, how to bring blue-green in gray cities which are very narrow. And I think with the ABC guidelines, we developed a lot of different tool sets, toolkits, what to do on the quantity and on the quality side, how to treat water. I don't want to go too deep into that. And the underlying question is always to be able to use nature-based solutions, because if we go away from nature, we have more and more the problem that we have enormous amount of water which we just lose. They just go away. Well, if we look at natural systems, they are more holding back, slowing down, treating water, and it's very important that we learn from that and use
this intelligence and bring it into our cities. And that's a big trick. And this is actually what I would like now to say very clear. It is not just to make the canal nice or to make on both sides, like a little bit more. I mean, this is great. And it's, I know how difficult it is. I'm not criticizing here. It's not my, I don't have the right to criticize because I think there are lots of conditions which are difficult. I was working with our team actually on one of the rivers where I was not so proud. I said, I wanted to do more. And when I look at it, I say, lost opportunity. But it is very important that we really think about the very early starting point. Where are the catchment? What can we do to slow down the process, to clean it before it gets into the drains, before it gets into the rivers, so that we have already clean water coming down, and then we can keep the water, recycle it, reuse it, and do something for that. One of the first pilot projects, and I don't want to go too deep into that, is of course Bishan Ang-Mo Kio Park. At that time it was only Bishan Park. And the Kalong River was this. It was a profile, very clear defined, somehow a little bit crumbling and falling apart, so it had to be done new. And one plan was of course to make it just a bit wider and a bit deeper and still use concrete. Then we said no. We should actually bring nature back to this. What can we do to make this, which is actually with two fences, water like a prison? Can we make it open? Can we free it up? Can we make a seamless transition between people, landscape, and water? And that was a big discussion. That was really a big discussion with a lot of criticism. It can all be done. And then we said, okay, let's do a test reach. Let's make a try. And so we made a test reach. And I know there are some people actually even here who were actually very, very supportive of that and were helping. We were also actually thinking we should do it here with NUS. But NUS was, sorry to say that, so complicated that they said, we need 3 years for all the process to get the final improvement. I said, forget it. I can't wait for 3 years to make my test reach. I need to do it within 1 year because I need to know what kind of plants can I use, what kind of soil can I use, what kind of techniques can I use, how to stabilize it. I have to see how quick the plants grow. If there is a flood coming up, you know, what? How is the plants reacting to this, what kind of interaction is. So we did it our own, out of our own pocket money. And then we created actually a test reach. But the result now is very beautiful because it's much wider. So it's a valley. We recycled a lot of the material. We brought it in here. Today it's a very, very sort of open thing, seamless thing. It can, of course, the water can go up. We have warning systems. Security was a big discussion. And it's all over the world a big discussion. And just to say this also in brackets, just in between the lines, and I think it's important also for you students. I think we have to start to think different about security and about safety. Because often we have something in our head where we think it is dangerous. But what is really dangerous if we don't educate the society to learn how to work with risks and how, and life is always risky. And, you know, we learned, for example, how to cross the street. We learned our kids to wait when there's red, we cannot go. Actually, with the environment, we have also to learn more and more that we have to behave in the right way with the environment. It's not up to the government to make everything okay. It is also important that actually children can learn when there's a rain and their water comes up, I have to stand away and have to, like people did in the past as well. I mean, there is no someone who can actually, we can blame all the time. I think this whole discussion about safety is something we have to start to rethink it. In Germany, it's a very big discussion how to change this behavior, for example, about playgrounds. Security companies cannot, or no one can always come and say, I'm blaming this because there was a stone to hire. So all these things we have to reconsider this question, what is safety? Yeah, well, that's just a side effect. And then actually today, I think Bishan Ang-Mo Kio Park is very beautiful. It is has lots of added values. It's a wonderful bird paradise. It has also, of course, challenges, because we have a lot of otters coming in. We have nature, which is sometimes not so behaving always like people want to see it. So we have to find also a kind of learning for that. And this whole question how to work with wild and with human life and how to bring that together, that's probably for the future, I think, a very big topic where we have to learn. Because often we try to see that nature is kind of very decorative, very controlled, how we imagine nature has to be. But that's not true. Nature is actually for itself, has its own life, its own regulation, and we have to be very actually respectful that we cannot bring our human perspective and our human mindset and to say nature has to be like this. And that's an interesting process, I think, for the future, which is coming up. Well, and that brings me to the point of the probably the next year's discussion, the city in nature and the city in nature targets what Singapore brought up. Here's the whole discussion we just mentioned already in. And that will be very, very interesting. You know, what can we learn step by step? And I'm so proud to see what is happening in Singapore right now. I mean, I just mentioned some points. We had Sungai Buloh as a very important milestone. We did work, actually, my team did work on this, and I was very happy to come up with the first design concepts and ideas on this, and then it was carried out with Savannah. And this is actually, a lot of people actually go there. We even have on some parts some crocodiles even. I've seen them. So it's a very interesting way how we get more close to it. We can see what we can do, what is risky, where do we have to work with it. But it's a step, it's a big milestone. I think another is recycled landscapes. You know, like this quarry, I think this is just opened this wonderful park of the Riffles Range Nature Park, which I think is fantastic. And it was also a learning curve to say, we can also have some footpaths with stones where we have to balance. It's not all smooth and two handrails. It's maybe no handrail. We have to, you know, find ways how we walk. That's great. It's a good step forward. And I think in the little streams which are running down. So beautiful project, beautiful examples. And I think this whole steps forward in Singapore, I think, is fantastic. I would like as a last one here from Singapore to show this one here. This is actually the Jurong Island Pond, which is not accessible for people because it's the island, which is really high industry and you need a special permission. But we were so happy actually to help on this. With JTC was here our client, and I was more or less consulting in workshops what they can do. This is actually maybe not even the last photo. I'm happy that I will see this in very, very soon and see it. We try to do the following. We take all, this is basically a reclaimed land. It's filled up sand, and it has streets, it has different plots where industry is coming more and more in. Rainwater runoff on the surface is coming out over there on one of the spots. So it's actually brought in here. These are some of the early sketches of that. So when water comes in, we can bring it in here. It can go up. It can start to infiltrate because islands always need fresh water so that the freshwater lens is pushing out the salt water, right? And this is actually also what is happening here. So when there's even more water coming up, we have special zones where infiltration can come in. We also protect some of the existing buildings with berms and so on. And actually, when there's a lot of water coming, then there will be an overflow. Yeah, but most of the water will actually be kept on the island and will refill the groundwater aquifer. These were some early sketches. And actually, it starts to look very much like this already. It's really coming up. And this is, I think, very beautiful to see, you know, how then also landscape design, landscape architecture, the right plants, the right biology, birds can come in. And I think there is lots of ways how to bring industry and environment more close together and really to find better solutions. I mean, the Jurong Eco Park is one another example, which I don't show pictures here, but I think this is also coming up very well. Now, finally, I would like to show at the end two things. One is, can we actually also do this in less, I could say it very simple, rich countries, which have not so much money like Singapore has, or my country has, or Switzerland has? Can we do it there as well? And I think yes, we can. But we probably have to do it different. We have to do different methods. We cannot over-regulate everything. Workers need also maybe some other advice. And I was very happy that one of my former colleagues and team member now started his own office. No, actually, this is a slide before. This is actually studios we did. We did two studios here at NUS with suburbs of Jakarta. What can we do to work here to develop the city and to make it so that it is water sensitive? And Raymond is actually sitting here. He was part of that, who is also part of my team and is helping and supporting me. I want to talk about this park, the Tabet Eco Park, right in the center, which was actually done by Anton Siura and his team. Siura's studio got also the President Design Award this year. And I think it's a very beautiful case. That's why I want to show it, because it's really a very, very nice example of almost a Bishan Ang-Mo Kio Park broken down to more simple solutions also. And it was actually done much faster, because all the process of, getting building permissions and all this, it was not needed. It was more important to find people who can do it. And Anton told me, Herbert, it was so actually exciting to work with the local people, because they had still a lot of skills they knew from the past. So it was really impressive. Well, this is Jakarta, all the problems of Jakarta, of course, that the land is going down and so on. And there's discussion about removing the entire city and so on. But still, I want to focus just a bit on that, what it is. In the region, we have, of course, all these problems we are aware of. The Chiliwung is a very clear example about how the sea was more and more squeezing the river, and then there's only trash going down, and when there's suddenly a lot of water, it was just flooding the entire city, and very, very difficult to deal with that. But this was his actually area where he said, okay, I want to make a change actually in this part of the canal, and I want to create a kind of park. A lot of skepticism, he told me, was also there. It cannot be done. People will not behave in the right way. They will still litter everything and will be damaged very soon. And he said, no, let's try. Let's go for that. That were the pre-existing park conditions there. And actually, honestly, when we look back and see pictures of Singapore, like 40 years back, it was also like that, I mean, yeah. And why not? I mean, that's also reality. And then they started really to come up with doing a lot of things, collecting the materials, the trees, taking things out, making things wider, recycling materials. Same what we did here on Bishan Ang-Mo Kio Park. Reuse, recycle, replant, come up with gabions. Very simple, but very effective. So, of course, there are where maybe not everything perfect. You could maybe have done this maybe a bit wider, the profile is, but you have to work with the conditions you have there. But today, this actually looks completely different. So he brought in some ideas about how to bring the community in, boardwalks, pavilions, and so on, the whole program. He made a very nice bridge construction to walk over. And this is a constructed wetland, and the whole thing can be flooded here. It can really, the water can go up, then you cannot use it, and then the water goes down, then you can use it again. And it's even more radical than what we have often in Singapore. And it's really interesting how that here starts to work. You see here, the water is here coming up. It can be even higher. There's a detention basin in the middle, where here is the footpath, a bit higher going over. And you see, these are some of the impressions. I haven't seen it myself, but I just wanted to share this with you because I think it's really a very well done work. Of course, he also used a lot of the bioengineering techniques we tested out. I think he made very, very good use of that. So I'm very proud about to see, you know, how people have been learning and really creating this and even learn more and bring this forward and really do things. There's a lot of wonderful places where people can collect beside bioengineering solutions. This is the way how people can walk and cross over. And I have seen pictures on weekends where it's packed full. And it's so successful that, of course, now this is a pilot project for Jakarta. And they say, it works. We didn't think it would work. But then developers start, okay, I want also to have that because it brings our real estate value up. Yeah. Okay, so this is actually what you can do. All right, I don't want to go over time too much. I want to come to the end and I come back to the art. And I just like to share you one project again in more temperature zones. This is an art experience in the city of Milwaukee, North America. I'm actually working there for an industrial area called for the district in Perth. And actually the district at the moment looks really very much run down. So this is actually Main Street, and the end of the Main Street in this area goes into an industrial zone. And it's like an ending here. And you can see this is winter time here. Milwaukee has seasons, very humid and hot summer, very cold and windy winters, and short spring, short fall. But the seasons are very important for the entire atmosphere of the city. And the water actually reacts to these four seasons. So the third ward district, which is this area, which is actually a very important district because, for example, companies like motorbikes, can you help me? Harley Davidson, right. I'm not an expert in this, but their factory is very close to this, for example, and other things. And actually, at the end, then we started with very simple sketches. And by the way, also students, when you have ideas, use hand sketches. Don't only think you need perfect renderings. You know, first ideas, just take a stick, draw. All the people I know around the world who are doing great design, they all do hand sketches. You can even have a little sketchbook, and you might have an idea sitting here, sketching it down, and you hold it. Yeah. So that's very important. Then you can, of course, do all kinds of renderings. This is how it looks at the moment. This is how we want to see it. We want to bring more life into that. Also, very simple sketches. And then, of course, you can also do a rendering later on to convince the client, maybe. I'm not a big fan of all these over-designed renderings, you know. It can actually be much simpler. and actually also for you as a school of design and environment, don't overdo things all the time because the expectations will go higher and higher and higher and higher, you know, but it's not getting better. The project is not getting better. It's often getting worse. So this is actually the place. This is how we want to see it. And now we started to construct it full scale. So in my hometown, I have a big place, a big factory, and I started to work on that. I did build it up full scale. I made the under construction, and this was actually this spring. It was March, April, May, I think, right? And Ray was one of the team members working on this project. So actually, we started here to build it up. Then we brought clay, 9 tons of clay, and we modeled all this clay by hand and made actually the forms to optimize the forms. We made it all on different scales and made all water kinds of tests. And then when we have done this and we made the water flow, we will see this at the end on a film. We scan it in with different methods. We use all the 3D points we digitalized all the different scales and measurements. And we optimized it And we did the water test with real water. And I think it's very interesting. That's what I also want to bring to you, because we are always using more and more computers. But I think it's very important to have a kind of relationship to the real materials. Yeah, and you can actually bring it together. Like, this is a good example how actually to bring the real sort of physical stuff and the computer technology together. You see here my team, who are young men, strong men here from, they were so happy to work on this. And actually, I think Raymond was taking the photo, right? So, okay, and then I think I will end with a small film on that. I will end with art. On that, and I hope it will work. So, is it working? Ah, yeah, okay. So, maybe we could take the sound a little bit louder. So you can see how that comes, because then we see also the water movement. So this was... Yeah. So, real scale water experiments, and then finally out of that the form comes out. Clay, 9 tons of clay modeled. And it looks crazy, but it is fun. And it is really, it's all actually is faster than using huge computer models, because you can see it and you can test it out and you can make corrections very quickly. You see how the water is running, you can see, okay, how can I make it? I can see all kinds of flow structures, and I put some color in, see what is happening. Test it, we carve it out, shape it, build up, take material from here to here. And the teacher is water. Water is teaching us by each test how to do it, how to change it, where to build it up, where to take it down. Actually, one of my dreams is that I could do something like this for Singapore in some place, but I don't know how this could work. But I think it's really fantastic to work on this kind of, not making jumping jacks, but really letting the water really be as it is, you know? And so here you see that we are now testing out a bit more, and I think the film will soon show then at the end how we take then the final measurements. Here we work on different details, even cut off and take in. And we did test it actually then also with people coming in. Even my grandchildren were then finally testing this, and they were really happy to work on this. So here we see also the forms, different shapes. And always water was then running, telling us what was okay, what did we have to change. We even had such a reciprocal form called flow form, what the English guy did work out. And here we work with the students of University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee. And now they scan everything, take it in, also the pump installations here. And here we are just starting to then build it up. Then the interim phase showcase. Okay, this is actually just, this was actually at the end, we had a kind of party. Every such a work needs a celebration at the end, right? And I think it's so important. Also, maybe a little bit in brackets, when you students have done a great work, celebrate your work. You know? I think work needs to be celebrated. And often here at NUS, we take it for granted and things are ready, and then we jump into the next thing. Take a break and say, we have done a great job. And we celebrate maybe for 1 hour, and then we go to the next. So these kinds of moments, you know, of really taking a stop, you can also take more than an hour. But don't overdo it, right? That's also, it has to have the right balance. Okay, so I think with this last film, we come to the end. This was some of the team of people who were working on the big scales, and here these guys are very happy. And I think that's the end, right? That's the end. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Prof, for that very inspiring lecture. It was beautiful. Before we go ahead, we sincerely want to apologize for the issue with the aircon. There was an issue with the central electrical system, so it's now resolved, so really apologetic for that. Now, I would like to invite on stage the moderator for the evening, Professor Dorothy Tang. Prof Tang is a landscape architect and assistant prof in the Department of Architecture at NUS, where she directs the Master of Landscape Architecture program. Her research and practice is concerned with the intersections of infrastructure and everyday life, especially in communities confronting large-scale environmental change. Her current research explores the urban and environmental impacts of Chinese overseas investments in Southeast Asia and Africa and the geopolitics of transnational watershed management. Please join me in welcoming her on stage.
Okay, so I'm on. Have a seat, please. I think Herbert needs to rest a little bit, so I will start by rambling a little. I really appreciated this talk. So just so you know, when I was a student, I had literally checked out Waterscape and New Waterscape from the library almost permanently. I think the library had to purchase more copies because they always had to recall it from me. So it's really such a pleasure to be here, and I hope for students that are out there that when I get you to do the clay thing next week, that you don't kill me. Anyway, I just wanted to summarize a few thoughts, and since I'm the moderator, I have the privilege of going first before everybody else gets to go. We have a little bit of feedback, but we'll just keep going. All right, so I really appreciated how, Herbert, you talked about the evolution of how nature-based solution went from something that was not accepted to something that is, a little bit mainstream at the moment, right? So I remember 15, 20 years ago, whenever I spoke to an ecologist, they would be like, oh, you're gonna put a wetland in a city? I was like, yeah, so how big does the wetland need to be? And they're always like, oh, just get as much as you can. Like, there's no, like, anything is better than nothing. I think this was the kind of attitude about 20 years ago when it came to nature-based solutions, thinking of water management and stormwater in cities. And now we have evolved into regulations and standards where in China, for example, 80% of the cities need to be converted in 5 years, into this incredible sponge, if it works. And so we have really, really come a long way in the past 15 to 20 years. But I mean, the beginning of your talk, you really are asking for much more radical change, right? Which is really difficult with water systems, with water catchment systems, basins that are territorial. I work on the geopolitics of I work on hydropolitics, right? So how nations and these large-scale water basins operate, right? And so they're territorial, they're at multiple scales. There's way too many stakeholders and communities that are involved. And yet climate change is real, we've experienced it, and it's accelerating much faster than we expected. What is the next step? Now, in all of our studios here at NUS, you know, ABC water is a standard, we teach it. Like I tell my students, if the only thing you came up with is a wetland, you kind of fail, because it's so part of what we do here in Singapore. What needs to happen next in order for us to address these really pressing issues?
Yeah, that's a very interesting and I think a very important question also. I mean, just maybe before I go to the final point of your question, the starting point is very interesting already, what you mentioned, is that, let's see, I have been working now for more than 40 years in this field. And I remember that before 2000, and actually with some of the projects even you have seen here, for example, the one in America, in Portland. In Portland, I was criticized by this project I think it was the Landscape magazine, the big American magazine for landscape architecture. There was one of the most important editors writing an article and said, this is not sustainable, this is boutique ecology. Huh. And what he meant by this, and it was really interesting. His opinion was, and that was actually many people were thinking so, nature is something which is out there. And it needs to be very big, large ecosystems, like big forest, and sorry, we don't have that, so we cannot deal with it. And the city is something different.
Right.
So the city is completely artificial, is manicured as everything, and we should not think about ecology in the city. So, so it was radical to say this was actually nature has nothing to do in the city. That was actually, I think, before 2000, very much the way how people were thinking and also educating in high schools. And when I think, you know, about discussions and when I look, very few people were starting to make the link to say, actually, there is no such separation. And then later on in the discussion came out that this is a completely negative term to say boutique ecology, because it was always thinking about kind of small, kitschy things. And then later we learned, especially about, for example, birds or bees or lots of other animals, that there is a network, what they need in the city. So ecology is actually not working that only one big thing is here, but there are green corridors, there are green networks, actually something we try to do in Singapore with the green network and the green corridors and the park connectors and so on. That was not seen before 2000. I think that was really, and that's why such a criticism was possible to be made, and a lot of people were agreeing to that, and I found it amazing. I did talk to this guy later on, and I said, he said, "No, you're right. It changed." and I think the same is the second part of your question: what can we do? And that's probably, this part is not so easy to answer for me, because I'm not in a position to say, you know, this will be what the next generation has to do. So I can just guess a little bit. And I think I try to make it clear in my speech that the way how we understand nature or how we think nature is often, I wouldn't call it boutique ecology, but I would maybe call it, it is a kind of nature we like to see, which is nice, which is good to handle, which is good to control, which is something we can actually add on here and here. And we kind of making kind of this kind of
ornamental nature.
Yeah, it's a kind of programming. You know, we program here, 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 and we don't see it as something where nature in cities is actually, there's no separation between the city and nature, because we are completely depending on the environment, on nature. That's what we can see with climate question, with food systems and so on. And we have to learn how human interaction with nature actually is, goes hand in hand. And we have probably to change also a lot of our behavior, because that's, for example, what I think will be a learning process about safety, about mobility, about what we eat. We eat much too much meat. If the whole population would eat like what we do in Singapore or in Germany, we would destroy our planet completely. So we have to learn more to eat more with vegetarian things. We have to change our food system, which is actually also more healthy. It creates better environments. It creates better natural systems, better ecosystems, and so on. I mean, it's not up to me to say, you are not allowed to eat anymore a nice Wiener Schnitzel, for example, or this or that. But it's the amount. I mean, if I think back even in my country, it's not so long ago, before World War II, people had only once a week meat. The rest was actually other things, you know. And this is very, very interesting. And actually also in China or in other countries, it was different. We take it for granted that we have everyday meat, and that's just one example. So I think it's also our behavior has to change, our perspective, our aesthetic approach has also to change. I think that's also what we think nature has to look so and so. We have a kind of aesthetic approach, which also has to change, and that's especially difficult if you work in Arabian countries, because they all want to have this lush green. And then you say, no, your nature cannot be lush green. Your nature is beautiful with silver, with this very fragile desert plants. Take that as beauty. Mm-hmm. So the whole question about aesthetics and about beauty is also something we probably have to rethink.
It takes some training, I guess. We have to train ourselves to do that. Thank you. I'm going to open up the floor to questions from the audience. Maybe what we can do is we can collect two or three. Let's collect three, and then we'll direct it to you. Please tell us who you are.
Hello, hi. My name is Eric Velasco, and I'm wondering how much science is involved in your designs to better understand their effect in the urban ecology, climate, biochemical cycles, for instance.
How much science is
involved in your
designs? Is in there? Yeah, I think, I think there's a lot of science what you have to include or what you can include. I'm very interested, for example, on effects. I mean, it's different things, actually, I have to say. I'm very interested in, you know, what are the effects if you do things, for example, of Bishan. I'll give you one example, Bishan Ang-Mo Kio Park. I would be so interested to find out what is the effect to psychology of people. You know, how do they behave? What's the influence on their well-being? If you have a better environment, what about how to fight depressions, how to fight diabetes, how to fight, for example, Alzheimer or such things? Can we do this through a better way of encouraging people that they move more outside? Does it have an effect? That's just one side. And I think we need to do more research to find out how is nature affecting our well-being and our health system. You know, I think Singapore is doing already things in this direction. I think that there needs so much more research on this. It's very, very difficult to find out which effect goes to what, but I think much more is needed, because then we would change our behavior in a way that we say, we know how important that is, and we have to invest much more in these things, because often it's only an add-on. Other things, I think on science, of course, a lot probably has to be done you can do a lot, for example, what kind of biological processes are going on in soil. We know very little about soil conditions. Yeah, how is water and microorganisms and the chemistry in good soil working? Soil is very much ignored often, or is only taken out what we can for agriculture, but phosphorus, nitrates, and all this is not just the only thing. Soil is full of life, full of organisms. We know very little about this kind of qualities, also for food systems, for food security. For the symbiotic elements to plants and to animals. It's just two fields I like just to mention. So research and science is extremely important, that we learn more to know about what is there. And I think maybe another one is, the danger is often in research that we only focus on one point. And I think what is extremely important is how these things play together, how they come together, what kind of interlink is between different disciplines? How is this affecting this? And how is this affecting that? And that's why I think, for example, on a university like here, more complex research programs where different disciplines come together, like we have in NUS Cities, what we try to do in this field. I think that's very, very important. I hope I answered a little bit.
Hi, hello, can you hear me? Okay, so my question is this. Most part of the cities...
Can you speak a little louder? Because yeah. I have my hearing aids doesn't work very good.
It's working now? Better? Okay, yeah. I'll just speak louder. Okay, so most parts of the cities...
You need to hold it.
Okay, is working? No.
No, I think that's...
Thank you. Hello. Now. Okay. So most part of our cities are the surface is used for roads and walkways. How to fight or how to think about the permeability that we can create on cities if we change the material and the way that we do all the roads and the walkways. Like, I'm also very interested and passionate about the water flow in the cities in all types of scales. And I have always wondered, why are we doing the streets and the walkways in the same impermeable way? If we do a minimal change on it, we can affect huge. So yeah, my question is, I don't know if you have thought about it or you have done any research on it. Yeah.
Very good point. It's actually a thing where we are just at, you're just coming, your question just comes to the right moment, because tomorrow we will have a meeting, especially on this topic about walkways and roads here at the NUS campus. Because when you, honestly, when you look at NUS campus and you see, and some of my students started to make a research comparing to other campus universities, how much is asphalt? How much is concrete? How actually boring this engineering is, only focusing on traffic. How our waterways are actually limited to very small canals to get the water very quickly down to EYE, and then a canal which is going there, and then bringing this water very quickly out. Yeah, it's totally the opposite to that what I was just showing on this talk. So we are actually thinking now at NUS, can there be better ways, more like a future plan, a future scenario, vision plan or master plan for the entire campus to change it, to make this, but that means also that we cannot just only redesign it, we also have to change our behavior. That means you cannot just come with the car and go to your car parking place very close to your studio or so. You maybe have to leave your car out of the campus. We are thinking of solutions where the campus is free of any motorized individual vehicles. Thinking about totally different ways of mobility, thinking about new ways of maybe having certain distances which are nice to walk, because it can be done. You can see it already at University Town, at U-Town, that people can use it when it's done right. But of course, on this side, we have still a situation where it is boring to walk and it's also not comfortable. So that's one thing. And if we have that solution, we can totally redesign the question how to collect water, how to slow it down, how to have maybe areas where we have a treatment train or a cleansing ways. So my students are, we have just a group of students who are just doing a kind of vision plan, testing it out, and tomorrow we will have a meeting to this.
I hope it works, because I agree with you. And no further comments from me, because I might get fired. But anyway, any other comments from the audience? Questions from the audience? Oh, there's questions on Zoom. All right, maybe I can, are we gonna? Okay.
So there are a few questions in Zoom, which I'll read them aloud. So first question is by Nathan. How can we incentivize blue-green infrastructure, given the associated costs, in a step towards making such design universal, the norm? Or will this be limited to government-initiated projects?
Did I get it? I didn't
Should
get
I
it.
What are the incentives for blue-green infrastructure, or are they just going to be government initiatives?
Ah, okay. Yeah, good point. I think that's very interesting. We made a research here at NUS looking at successful projects. That was actually some years back, but it's a very interesting paper. You might be interested. It was actually done by NUS together with Harvard GSD, Christian was part of that. And no, I don't know if Christian was there, but I think we did four universities. We had the Zeppelin University in Germany, we had NUS, we had the MIT, and we had Harvard GSD, right? And looking at successful multiple projects. And it's very interesting that it is important to have a kind of leadership, and it's often important to have policymakers or people who are on a leadership from the government side to enable this kind of thing. So it is very important to have kind of programs or a clear vision where the city wants to go. That's one side. So clear vision, clear direction is a very, very important tool. Having said this, it needs also some other aspects as well. We figured out about 5 points, which are all important for successful projects. By the way, leadership means also, it's not just anonymous, it is also persons. We need a very charismatic person who can be a leader. Because the work can only be done by humans. And you know, if a strong personality is there and saying, I want to see that, and that can be someone from the government, it can be someone, I mean, these are very important people. They take leadership, they take it as an ownership thing, which is their personal thing, and so we have to support them. But then there are other components, and I just mentioned only very, very quickly some others. You can read this paper, it's quite interesting. For example, you need to create some capacity, knowledge in the society to be accepted. So it's both top-down, bottom-up. You have to involve the people in this. And it actually is very important that a society is ready for change by being convinced and saying, yes, we will have a win-win effect from that. And that's so, you can never do it just overloading it. You have to bring it up. And then, of course, you have to train the professional world. That's also, I think, what Singapore is doing. And you have to take any opportunities also to think different about money. I think financing has to be more smarter and more long-term visions to create value. And we have to think also about money in a different way. That's also, I mean, that, I cannot go too deep into that. It's very complex, but all these things matter.
Great. I'm going to ask another question on Zoom by Lian Heng. Having worked with both nature-based solutions in both temperate and tropical climates, what are the unique observations in the outcome of landscape design from your experience?
In climate. Yeah, it is. I think every climate zone has certain conditions where you have to be very sensitive. I mean, I was really lucky. I think I'm one of the very few people on this planet who had also bigger projects really on very different climate zones. And I was, for example, doing projects in Finland on the polar circle. And I give you this example because a lot of people there were saying your system will fail because you cannot infiltrate, you cannot hold back water in our climate because it will ice, it will be dangerous, it will be all this. And you have to be, of course, very much aware about climate zones, and you have to figure out how can you do it, how can you manage water in this kind of area. And you have to listen very carefully also as a planner to understand this. And I'm very often, I try to live there also a certain time. I was, for example, Bishan Ang-Mo Kio Park, I was living 1 week in a little shed with my team, without air condition, by the way, to see how is the situation in Bishan Ang-Mo Kio. And what is a big storm when it rains? How does it work? How do people behave? So observations and being sensitive to the conditions, not only on climate, but also on social behavior of people and cultural behavior is extremely important besides these facts. But everywhere on the world, there are ways to find better solutions, and especially on water. I mean, in Finland, we have a wonderful project harvesting snow, holding it back, melting the snow in the spring. The water is clean, released into the East Sea, Ostsee, and it's a wonderful project. Actually, it's working since 20 years now. And it's also a pilot project for many, many other projects which did follow. So each climate zone has different conditions, but it's possible to work in each climate zone if you adapt yourself to this.
I'm going to direct. I think there's a few questions from the audience, right? This gentleman over here.
Thank you. Hello. Hi. Can you hear me? Awesome. Hi, Prof. Herbert. It's a pleasure to hear you speak. And my name is Meherwan. I study philosophy and anthropology of architecture at Yale NUS nearby. I was really interested to hear what you had to say about bio-inspired design and biomimicry, but in the concept of not citywide, but like within departments and within spaces. And not only, I think, is like nature a part of the city, but rooms and like city spaces within our environment have to be interconnected. So the outdoor and the indoor as well have to be interlinked in some way where, for example, if the air conditioning goes off, we are not stumped with the heat. Or if it is raining like crazy, it's not either full rain on us or no rain at all because we're indoors. It seems like trees provide a really interesting solution where they layer the water droplets so that we are not attacked by the harshness of it. And I'd like to ask you if you have worked in that space of integrating the indoor and the outdoor and your experiences within that.
Very good point. Yeah, I think there's also, there's a very good point about the transition zones between inside and outside, and also the transition zones between inside living for humans and outdoor or outside nature, and how that actually can be more seamless. And also, I think I cannot give a general answer to this because there is no general answer. It can only be done so and so. There are many ways to do it. But I think also that, especially here in Singapore, we have just the last couple of years, Man Sam, for example, from Woha, was really testing out things which were, by the way, very, very much appreciated around the world. I mean, it's quite amazing how many people, you know, react to this kind of examples in Europe or in America, to see that, okay, there could be greening structures on different heights, or there could be hotels where you have no air condition, only in the rooms, but the corridors are actually outside and you walk there, and there's just some shade and there are some trees and you suddenly accept it. That's the interesting thing. Even it's, you can measure it's warm, but when I walk there and I'm in this environment, I think, oh, wow. And actually we have even a word for that. We say it's cool, right? But it's still warm, but it's cool. So I mean, this kind of things, you know, human behavior and design and environment really matters. And I think there's lots of things what we can learn how to bring this together. And I think, I mean, the other point was really about where I think we have to really find out much more how near can nature come to us and how can we get to nature. I mean, we just had, I was just joining here an interesting conference on tigers, how to save tigers in Malaysia and you know, how can actually, is the wildlife actually working with humans together? I mean, I cannot give the answers, but I think it's great that these questions are coming up. And it's just the last chance because there are only 100 tigers left over in Malaysia. 30 years ago, it was more than thousands. Yeah, so they're soon extinct if we don't have better ways. So it's a very interesting question. I think that the question comes up and we find to new ways. And I think your generation will be the ones who have to work on it. We can only give some impulses and you have to really find the answers.
Any other questions from the audience before we move on to Zoom questions?
There's one more question behind.
Hello, yes. I'm Clemens. I'm on exchange from Germany and I have a question. I think we all agree that these super high density urban conditions are not really livable. And now you and your colleagues develop solutions that make them more livable. And my question would be, isn't that a bit avoiding the general question if these urban conditions should even exist?
That's a very German question.
because we can afford to have, you know, to spread out still, but here in Singapore you cannot. I mean, that's really, I think that's really interesting. I mean, that if you have density and you have lots of people and we need this, we need to live in a relatively dense situation. The question is really how to find new forms of even having density, but still to bring green and blue together. And that's I think, a very big challenge. But I think, again, to say that what, I mean, there is some literature, you probably also know some books. Just Singapore has, for example, Dense and Green, the book from... From Thomas Schröpfer. Also a German guy, by the way. He did write a book about collecting these kind of ideas, and I think it is something we cannot say that cities should not be dense, because then what would happen? We would spread out. It's, by the way, a discussion we also have in Germany quite a lot. How much density can we actually should we have? And for example, in our city, where my wife and I, we are also part of the parliament, we are often discussing, shouldn't we bring more density also in our city so that we don't spread out and actually take more land for the city? So it's a good question, but I think the answer cannot be density should not be. I think density is also important.
We have a question
there. Thank you. To continue with the topic of density, my name is Nirit. I'm a student here. A PhD student, but I've been living in Singapore for more than 20 years. So I think the concept of density could be understood in different ways from different parts of the world. Maybe as you come from Germany, I don't know which part, but I think one of the things that we see in this part of the world, in this region, is that we start to see density as a positive value, and we can start to see how density brings qualities of living so it's a matter of perception. I just want to give you some examples from my own research from the neighborhoods in Singapore. So you can see nature in different scales, I believe. For example, what I hear from the residents, even in a car park, in a very dense HDB neighborhood, 45, 47 stories development, trees in the car park becomes a piece of nature to them. And people from all over the island, bird watchers, they come and there's a great excitement. Residents talk to me about the joy of having birds landing in their common corridor and visiting them, and they will prepare a place for them to nest. So I think maybe we can start to see it we can start to break the density topic into a human scale. Thank you.
Do you have any thoughts on that?
No, I think that's fully agree. The real question is, that will be also the future question. How can we bring quality and density together? Because density also has, I mean, that's always a discussion where when people are more close together, the social network, the culture we can create, you know, if we socialize more, we have more culture. We have some people were even saying that I heard on conferences. Why did people come together in cities? One was, of course, to make easy life easier, infrastructures, food, health, and so on. But another important part is it is more fun. You have more. Enjoyment with other people. Sometimes you can also be getting angry of your neighbor, but it's actually someone cares of you, and we can see this also very, very strong in our city. I'm happy that I live in a house with lots of families. I don't want to have my own single house because I would feel lonely. And I just love, and if something happens to one family, like one part of the family is maybe of a couple is dying, and you live alone in a house, that's happening so often in America, for example, or in other cities, also in Germany can happen, then it's much better if you are in a community, because then you have resiliency, you have a social network which is helping you. So there are lots of arguments why density is also good.
Okay, we have one last question because I'm supposed to shut this place down. Any other questions?
Hi, hi, Herbert. I was a student from years ago. I don't know if you recognize me. But anyway, so because your topic today is talking about climate resilient cities, and I was wondering, now that rising sea levels and climate change is such a big issue in Singapore and all over the world, I wonder if you've done any work to, I don't know, mitigate rising sea levels or anything that's related, remotely related to seawater.
To seawater, you mean coastal protection and such things?
Coastal projects, maybe.
Yeah, that's a very, very, very important point. I mean, I'm very interested in this topic. I had actually the studios I had here for before COVID was actually I had two studios on coastal protection. Also on, I mean, part of the studio was also the coastal thing in a part of Jakarta where they have mangroves and they actually create whole forests, they cultivate mangroves for coastal protection. And that was absolutely fascinating for me, you know, how that can actually work together. And maybe you know this place also. I mean, that's, or I can share it with you because it's fantastic to go there. I mean, that's mind blowing. So these things, for example, are very, very important. And I'm not an expert on coastal protection, but I think a lot more can be done between hard engineering and soft engineering, and bringing also letting nature do a certain job. We know that, for example, where we have plants or we have vegetation, where when the tsunami was there, the coastal areas which had mangroves, there was not so much damage than the places where we had nothing. And the whole energy was actually getting to the coast. So I think it's an important topic, but I'm not solely expert on that. But it's a very important topic.
All right. I'm on, right? Okay, well, thank you so much for that question. More work. You can't retire now. You have to keep going. Thank you so much, Herbert, Thank you so much, Herbert, for being here with us tonight and sharing your work and sort of long trajectory and hard fights. I know it's hard work to get what you have accomplished completed. So thank you to the audience. And on that note, I'll pass it back to...
Thank you, Prof. Herbert and Prof. That's the problem of having too many mics in a lecture theater. Thank you, Prof. Herbert and Prof. Dorothy, for giving us your valuable time and having this very interesting lecture, as well as this very, exciting Q&A sessions. I'm sure we've all learned a lot from the lecture. Thank you, everyone, for attending this event and also participating with your questions. For the upcoming events, you can follow us on Instagram and LinkedIn, and we will keep updating you about future events. Yeah? Thank you, and we hope you have a good evening.